This is a question about Arkansas ag trade. Our approach to the Chinese buying American rice has not worked. Every few years, some lawmaker will make news touting some new and improved agreement with the country that never materializes into a significant amount of Arkansas rice being sold to the largest rice consumer in the world. How do we need to change our approach in this regard?
Well, I think this is a pathology with the Chinese, where they promise they want to do business with us, they just got to get a look at our operation, and yet we never see this materialize. I think we have to rethink the way that we do business in China. And I think, honestly, as important as that market is, I think we need to view it through the lens of a retail destination. That means we need to have a much more prominent presence in the Pacific Rim with trading partners with which we already have agreements, for example, Japan or India or even Vietnam, and allow them to be distributors of our products, whether that be rice or soybeans or any other products that they're reliant on. And I would say this, that China's demand picture is inelastic. They're going to need U.S. farm commodities, whether it be corn or soybeans or even rice. And I think they throw up these barriers because they want to come to the United States, they want to come to Arkansas, and they want to steal our proprietary information and take it back and use it in China. And we've seen the evidence of this with those rice researchers at the University of Arkansas that were caught stealing proprietary research. And I think we need to rethink our relationship with regard to trade in China.
And 1 minute now for Mr. Hodges.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for the question. You know, I'm no expert on agriculture, but I know that I live in a district. District 55 is probably the largest row crop producing county in the state of Arkansas. And so I know how important it is not to have barriers for our farmers to be able to trade freely in this country. So, you know, I would make every effort I could, being that we are in a large, I've traveled throughout this entire 1st Congressional District, and I've seen all the farm fields, all the cotton and all the soybean, all the things that we're growing here in the state. So most definitely agriculture would be on the forefront of any decision I make, and I would ensure that we not make it cumbersome for our farmers to be able to trade abroad.
And we go back to Mr. Crawford for 30 seconds, sir.
Yeah, I think what I said before, what we see is a continued aggressive and belligerent posture from the Chinese with regard to trade here in the United States, and that's particularly problematic for us here in the state of Arkansas because we are prolific rice producers, obviously, but we're a significant soybean producer as well. So I do think it's important that we rethink our posture with how we access a very important market in the global marketplace.
Mr. Hodges, you have another 30 seconds, sir, if you choose.
Again, you know, I would assure that we not have barriers, that we would look at not having barriers with allowing our farmers to be able to trade abroad.
All right. Our next question comes from Ms. Munoz, and it goes first to Mr. Hodges.
Okay, thank you. So if elected, you will be representing the people of Arkansas within your district. What makes you qualified for that position? Mr. Hodges, we start with you.
Thank you for that question. You know, the first district is... If there's 31 counties in the 1st Congressional District, we are the poorest congressional district in the state of Arkansas, with the lowest median household income, lower than that of Mississippi. Since I've been elected, went into the State House as a freshman legislator, my colleagues entrusted me to carry the largest economic incentive package the state had ever offered, which is Amendment 82, which drew Big River Steel, $1 billion steel mill, to my district. Now my district has the And since then, U.S. Steel has combined and made a $4 billion seed. So since that time, a corner of the state, which was considered economically dead at one time, is now the largest steel producer in the U.S., has the highest weekly take-home earnings than any other district in the state of Arkansas. So I'm proud of that record of economic development, and I need to take that throughout the entire 1st Congressional Corridor where the people are struggling and seeking good jobs.
Mr. Crawford, you have 1 minute, sir.
Yeah, thank you for that question. I think it's important that we view economic development as an important topic, and we tend to focus, and we should, because Mississippi County is a case study on how to do things right with regard to attracting new industry. It's ground zero for steel production. It certainly is the largest steel producing county in the nation, but we also need to look beyond the county of Mississippi County and look to the whole First District and recognize the value of economic development. And it's not always smokestacks on the horizon. Sometimes it's the small mom and pop businesses that account for 3, 4, 5 employees that can help empower rural economies. And so I think that's important to note as well. But I would say this, I've served this district now for 6 terms. I know this district very well. I have a very broad agricultural background. Agriculture is our number one driver of our economy in this district, in fact, in the state. So I think that I'm very well suited to have served this and to continue to serve this district.
We return to Mr. Hodges for 30 seconds.
Yes, again, as I've traveled this district, it is the poorest district in the state of Arkansas. And the question that keeps coming up is, we want those good jobs. What are you guys doing in Mississippi County to bring economic development to your, we want $125,000 a year job just like you guys have. I'm a banker. I know the importance of small business. I undergird small business all the time. I write business plans for small business. I work for the largest community development bank in the state of Arkansas. So we definitely have to undergird our small business and support them as well.
Mr. Crawford, 30 seconds.
Yeah, I do agree that small business is really the backbone of our economy, whether it's in the state of Arkansas or across the country. And I think one of the things that serves those small businesses is good education. What we've done in our office is to pair up educators with industry, and we do an annual STEM tour where we partner with Arkansas State University, bring educators to industrial sites so they know how to prepare their students for the skills that are going to be necessary for them to thrive in the workplace.
Question for both gentlemen, of course, and obviously we'll begin, Congressman, with you, and I'll follow up on Mr. Jared's question a bit. For multiple generations now, Arkansas farmers have wanted to sell their products, both row crops and protein, to Cuba. It never seems to go anywhere either. The embargo remains in place. What can you do to lift that embargo, and is this the time to resume negotiations on that in light of the Cuban government's lack of cooperation, alleged, regarding the oral assault on the U.S. embassy there?
I think it's important that you mention that, and thank you for that question. I've traveled to Cuba many times. I've been on the forefront of trying to normalize ag trade relations with Cuba. It's been a difficult obstacle, and most of those difficulties are thrown up by the Cuban government themselves, not the Cuban people who want us there. And we have a familial bond with the Cuban people, if you really want to get right down to it. We should be doing business in Cuba, but we can't do it because their regime prevents it from happening. They control everything. The communist regime there really is the main impediment to us being able to engage in commerce. They don't pay their bills, and they have a history of that. Certainly, Cuba would be an awesome destination for Arkansas rice. As I said, I've been there many times. I have taken farmers from Arkansas to see what they have available, to see how we might be able to access. And again, they throw up roadblocks. This time, it was with their doubling down of support of President Maduro in Venezuela. You mentioned the sonic attacks against our diplomats. Those are the kinds of things that prevent us from doing business in Cuba.
Mr. Hodges, you have 1 minute, sir.
You know, it's my belief, if people don't want to do business with you need to step back and ask yourself, do we really want to do business with them? But it's about building relationships. How are we building relationships when it comes to our Cuban friends or the Cubans? But it's all about building relationships. But it's my belief that if they're not wanting us to do business with them, then we need to step back and see if it's something that we really desire to do. Or should we move forward with it?
All right, Mr. Crawford, another 30 seconds if you choose, sir.
Again, we had an opportunity. We came very, very close. I had an amendment on the floor that we could have passed. And the Maduro, the Díaz-Canel regime, who I thought were going to be poised to be reformers, decided to take a different tack and support Maduro and continue to obfuscate on their responsibility for the sonic attacks on our diplomats. And I don't have the desire to spend political capital on this issue when we don't have a willing partner in Cuba to allow for us to trade there.
Mr. Hodges, another 30 seconds.
Again, it goes back to what I said, and I think it was just repeated that, you know, if they have no desire to do business with us, why are we continue to pursue it? Let's just step back and regroup and see how do we move forward from this point.
George Jared, first to Mr. Hodges.
In Arkansas, it's virtually impossible to get an abortion now, even in cases of rape and incest. Mr. Hodges, should there be exceptions to that, to those laws? And if not, tell us why.
Absolutely. You know, I spoke against this bill during the 93rd General Assembly adamantly, how restrictive it was. You know, it's a woman's health issue, and it's a human rights issue. I think we've crossed the line when it comes to telling women what they should do with their bodies, particularly when it's a health risk involved. And so most definitely, I did not support it then. Abortions are gonna happen. What's gonna happen is we're gonna have these underground abortions where people go back to using clothes hangers and turpentine, which will then not only hurt that child, but hurt that mother as well. So it's a health issue with me more than anything. And it's a women's right issue.
Mr. Crawford.
Yeah, thank you for that question. I have demonstrated over the years I'm very much pro-life. I've been endorsed by National Right to Life, Arkansas Right to Life, and I believe in that. I think the question we should be asking are, what aren't the restrictions that the Democrats like Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer are not willing to entertain? For example, they are pushing a bill in the House of Representatives right now that would say it's okay to take the life of that unborn child right up to the point of delivery. And there may be even, there's some gray areas in that legislation that may even allow for partial birth abortion, which we had thought had become a thing in the past. But now we see significant language that could inject doubt into the future of banning the practice of partial birth abortion. So I think a more relevant question would be, what do you not support with regard to, are there no limits at all? Are we saying that right up to the point of delivery that it's okay to take the life of that unborn child? And I say no to that.
Mr. Hodges?
You know, we need, first of all, we need to leave it up to the experts. You know, I'm a man, so I know nothing about a woman's reproduction. I know nothing about a woman's body, but I know she knows best what's best for her. And, you know, we have laws put in place like stand your ground. I no more want to kill a person because I feel threatened that they're going to attack me when we already have, great laws that protect us than I do want to hurt an unborn child. But, you know, we're looking at a health issue of that mother. And that's what's important to me.
Mr. Crawford, back to you.
Again, I would just say this, that I don't think, and this is a question that's not asked often enough for those of us that are pro-life, and we tend to get this question a lot, but the question is never asked on what restrictions are you willing to entertain if you are pro-choice? And at this point, we see the Democrat Party in Washington positioned to make that carte blanche any point during that pregnancy without regard to sex selection, you name it, you can have that abortion, and I don't support that.
Ms. Munoz has our next question. It goes first to Mr. Crawford.
Yes, thank you. So as you might know, in preparation for these debates, we also allowed viewers to submit questions via social media, and we want to be sure we get some of those in. So this question is coming to you from Garland County. Senator Ron Johnson has said he wants to see Social Security and Medicare be moved from entitlement status to the annual discretionary budget. And a lot of Arkansans, as we know, use those programs. Do you support a plan like this? Why or why not? Mr. Crawford, to you first.
I think it's relevant to talk about how we take all mandatory spending and put it into discretionary spending, not just entitlement programs like Social Security. But I think we also need to be thinking about how our open border is putting pressure on social programs, because those social programs, particularly Social Security and Medicare, are designed to support American citizens. What we're going to see because of Joe Biden's lack of concern over the border crisis that we see, where millions of illegal aliens are coming into this country, they're going to avail themselves of those resources that people have worked for and expect to receive as senior citizens. And those benefits are being diminished, and we're seeing that money diluted over the course of years that bad policy like open borders creates that problem that makes it even worse. And so I'm for putting all of it in discretionary spending and make us do right by the American people and spend their tax dollars more wisely.
Mr. Hodges?
You know, I think what first of all, what needs to happen is, you know, I think people think politicians have all the answers. We need to hear from from Arkansans and from the from citizens to first of all educate them on the issue, and then get feedback from them on how can we better serve you when it comes to issues like Social Security. You know, I can't focus on issues like protecting borders when we have issues and concerns right here in our backyard, particularly in this first congressional district, which is, like I said, a poor district. You know, a saying that I heard coming up as a kid is that charity starts at home, then goes abroad. So we need to focus on our issues here at home before we can try to deal with issues abroad at this point.
Mr. Crawford, you have another half minute if you choose.
Well, I think we need to walk and chew gum at the same time. We do need to worry about our border crisis. That's imperative. It's a national security imperative. We have to have a secure border. If we don't have a secure border, we don't have a country. And if we don't have a country, what's the point of messing with Social Security? The point is this: Social Security has problems. It's rapidly approaching the point at which it will no longer be liquid. And the border crisis is exacerbating and accelerating that problem to the point that we are going to not be able to keep our promises to our senior citizens.
Mr. Hodges?
You know, Social Security has had a problem for a long time. We keep it sovereign at this point and work on, like I said, getting people together, getting people in the room, finding out the best solution to fix it. And again, you know, I can't focus on border issues when I have issues here in the first congressional district that I need to address. You know, I'm not saying that we should have an open border, but we have to address things right here in Arkansas first.
Question first for Mr. Hodges, and it follows up on Mr. Jared's question regarding abortion. Since Roe was repealed, there have been proposals in and out of Congress from the left and the right, from conservatives and progressives, that abortion should be addressed statutorily, either guaranteeing the right to an abortion or banning abortion. If you were elected, sir, how would you regard that legislation? Would you support it?
Absolutely. I would definitely support it. You know, like I said, I've been consistent in my decision when it comes to a law that was in place almost 50 years ago that we've dismantled and you know, because it worries me that if we can so easily dismantle a law that's been in place for 50 years, are they going to come after civil rights legislation, things that affect me, the people that look like me? So that's a slippery slope. So most definitely, that would be something I definitely would address, because it's a woman's right issue, and it's a health issue, as far as I'm concerned.
Mr. Crawford.
Well, I would think the Dobbs decision, my opinion is it's the right decision, and that it relegates that decision to the state legislatures. And the 10th Amendment is clear on this. For those issues that are not specifically listed, enumerated in the Constitution, the authority to address those issues resides in the states. That's basically what the Dobbs decision said. And so it didn't outlaw abortion. It said the states would make that decision, and I support that. With regard to legislation, I certainly don't support the legislation being proposed by Speaker Pelosi and Senator Chuck Schumer, as I mentioned before, that allows for abortion on demand for any reason right up to the point of delivery, and may even provide enough gray area that the interpretation could extend to partial birth abortion. So no, I don't support that at all.
Mr. Hodges?
You know, we've made this about partisan, when it should be about people. It should be about women, and it should be about their rights to choose what they would like to do with their own bodies. We should not be making those decisions as lawmakers, and I just adamantly believe that we've just overstepped our boundaries, and I would support any efforts to ensure that we get back to allowing the woman to make her own decision.
Mr. Crawford.
Again, my position is that the Dobbs decision got it right. I think even Ruth Bader Ginsburg agreed that the Roe decision was problematic because of the 10th Amendment. The Dobbs decision relegates that authority to the states, where I think it should reside.
Mr. Jarrett has the next question, and it goes first to the congressman.
Congressman, this is a question about election integrity. You voted not to certify the election of Joe Biden as President of the United States. Do you now believe he was lawfully elected? And if not, what specific evidence do you have of election fraud? And I'll make an addendum to that question for Mr. Hodges. What steps do you think we need to take to ensure that we have safe and secure elections in the United States?
There were two states addressed on the certification, Arizona and Pennsylvania. In both those cases, there was a demonstrable violation of the U.S. Constitution in that unauthorized individuals changed election law in cycle while it was happening. Whether that be a judge that extended the deadline for absentee ballots, or whether that be Secretary of State or commissioner that allowed for drop boxes in unauthorized locations, whatever. Article 1, Section 4 is clear. The authority to regulate elections resides exclusively with the state legislature. Governors can't change the law. Secretaries of State can't change the law, neither can judges. That was the basis for my decision, and no other conspiracy theories or fraud theories were present, and I've been consistent in that from day one.
Mr. Hodges.
Who says that we do? I think we do have a fair election process. To be the only Arkansas delegate to sign off not to validate the election, which it was a conspiracy theory, from my opinion, which led to January 6th, is I can't wrap my mind around it. We have a fair election process. We're starting to put measures in place. Voting should not be cumbersome. We should make the process as less cumbersome as possible so that people can cast their ballot, because, you know, in this democracy, and have a choice, because that's their voice. But to say that, you know, the election was stolen is baffling to me.
Mr. Crawford, back to you.
Well, to be clear, I never said the election was stolen. I said the Constitution was violated in those two cases that I cited, and the evidence is clear on that. That's number one. I'm also glad to hear my opponent say that he thinks we have fair elections, because so often we hear Democrats talking about any number of made-up cases where they feel like there's, you know, Republicans are engaged in voter suppression, which is just not true. And so that's progress. I will say that. But I remain committed to the statement I just made. Pennsylvania and Arizona were the two opportunities we had to cast a vote, and in both cases, the Constitution was violated.
Mr. Hodges, back to you for 30 seconds.
So let past tense. We had fair elections. I'm not going to get into this partisan blame game, but the Republicans have put suppressive legislation in place, voter suppression legislation in place over the past several years that make it difficult. Arkansas looked more like D.C. this past 93rd General Assembly than I've ever seen when it comes to voter suppression legislation.
Ms. Munoz has a question that goes first to Mr. Hodges.
Yes, as we have mentioned, both the steel industry and agriculture are key in your district, and both are taking a major hit with the negative impact and with the negative impact of the economy and the downturn of the economy going on. What can be done in this role to help not only Arkansans, but the Arkansas small business owners in your district? Mr. Hodges.
Thank you for that question. You know, going back to what I said earlier, the Eastern Arkansas is now the largest steel producer in the U.S. We have the highest weekly take-home income than any other district in the state of Arkansas. So we've done some things right in Eastern Arkansas when it comes to economic development. And I went to Helena, West Helena. This is the business called Delta Dirt, where these small business owners have made sweet potatoes. They make gin and they make vodka out of it, a very family-owned business. They got it right. They were creative. And we need to ensure that we undergird businesses like that that are creative and ensure not that they just start a business, but that they are sustainable, because we see so many businesses that don't have the capital to stay sustainable. So we need to ensure that we make sure our small businesses are sustainable.
1 minute for Mr. Crawford.
Yes, on the steel industry, I've been chair of the Steel Caucus, or co-chair of the Steel Caucus, for the last four terms in Congress. There's not a stronger advocate for the steel industry than me. I think that's important to note. I serve on the Ag Committee. I know how important ag is to our economy here in Arkansas. I got a call from a farmer earlier this week, and he had been alerted that expect interest rates to be at 9% and possibly above for your production loans next year. We are on 4% interest rates for this year's production loans. We have not begun to feel the effects of what this economy will wreak on our consumers. And we could reverse course easily and help our small businesses, help our steel industry, help our ag industry thrive by just making some simple decisions for this administration to return to a domestic energy production, for example, and see these interest rates start to decline and improve our supply chain access to goods and so on. So there's some simple things that could be done to address it.
Mr. Hodges?
Speaking of, energy and things of that nature, there was a bill that was put on, a bipartisan bill, Build Back Better, which would have addressed the energy issues and things of that nature that my opponent voted against, and an infrastructure bill that was voted against. And all, agriculture, all these things are tied to infrastructure, tied to energy and all that. And so, we have to ensure that we're doing things here as lawmakers to ensure that they're successful.
Mr. Crawford.
Let me say this. I've served on two conference committees for highway bills, the FAST Act and MAP 21. The infrastructure bill was a partisan exercise in the House. We didn't get any opportunity to amend that, and then there was no conference so that we had an opportunity to further refine that legislation. So to call that a bipartisan bill is a stretch on a good day. There's no reason to think that bill was anything but a partisan exercise that enhanced and forwarded President Biden's ability to create more economic problems here in this country.
For both gentlemen, Mr. Crawford, we'll begin with you. You have a debt, Congress has a debt a vote coming up soon. And there apparently is a movement, or so we're told, to address entitlement programs or allow the debt ceiling to expire. One of your colleagues has suggested, from Arkansas, has suggested that default should be an option in the negotiations. And if I may follow up, sir, did we understand you to say that undocumented immigrants are participating in Social Security and Medicare?
No, what I said was to clarify that at some point they will receive those benefits, and they haven't paid into the system. And so therefore it's going to put more downward pressure on our ability, on our solvency of those funds. So just to clarify, that wasn't my point at all. Although for what we know, it's quite possible that they are receiving those benefits. In fact, I had a farmer send me an IRS form asking H-2A workers to apply for $30,000 tax credits. So we don't know the extent to which illegals and legal immigrants are being engaged by agencies such as the IRS. So just to clarify on that, and in fact, it probably didn't clarify, it probably muddied the waters even further, but that's emblematic of the problem on our border.
As for the debt ceilings are in default.
Okay, and I don't think we need to default, but I do think we need to do some things differently and fundamentally change the way we spend taxpayer monies. And that's going to require, quite frankly, a constitutional amendment, balanced budget amendment, or a spending limitation amendment.
Mr. Hodges.
No, I don't think we need to default. We've dealt with a pandemic that nobody expected to happen, which has caused all kinds of issues, a war. So a lot has transpired. Nobody has a crystal ball. My major was business administration, finance, and emphasis in economics. And even our greatest economists can't predict the future. They have no crystal ball to determine that. Things happen. So I most definitely don't think we need to put a cap on it.
Mr. Crawford, 30 seconds.
Again, we have a problem with spending in Washington. And the way I think we can address that is to fundamentally alter the way Congress spends your money. We can do that with a balanced budget amendment, which I have voted on before. Happy to do it again if I get the opportunity. Or we can do it with a spending limitation that caps spending as a percentage of GDP. In either case, if we don't change the way Congress spends your money, we are going to see this crisis bubble up year after year after year, and it becomes a political issue and a wedge issue that we don't make good choices on.
Now back to Mr. Hodges for a half minute, if you wish.
You know, the recent Inflation Reduction Act is dealing with that issue when it comes to the deficit. So it's being addressed through that piece of legislation, which we hope to help, you know, solve that problem.
Mr. Jarrett has a question first for Mr. Hodges.
Mr. Hodges, Congress will formulate a new farm bill next year. What specific changes do you think need to be made to the farm bill to aid Arkansas farmers who have had probably the worst season that they've had in decades?
You know, as I say, you know, I live in the largest row crop producing county in the state. I know, and even as a banker, I see the million-dollar farm loans. I see the things that our farmers have to deal with. You know, I spoke with a friend who's a farmer, and he said, you know, farmers have 40 years to get it right. They start when they're in their 20s, and you know, and by retirement age of 60, 65, you know, it's either feast or famine. And so he said, you know, we miss, you know, we have one bad year. It takes us 2 years to recoup. And I think we need to, you know, we as lawmakers need to understand that and put measures in place. They're not getting a weekly paycheck or monthly paycheck or biweekly paycheck. Their livelihood is based annually. It's based on the price of crops, the price of equipment and things of that nature. So we need to ensure that we make sure our largest producers in the state are safe.
To the congressman for 1 minute.
Yeah, thank you for that question. I think there are a couple of issues that we need to focus on in the next farm bill. One of them is there are some flaws in price loss coverage, and that is that the reference prices that are the support prices that trigger a payment are based on 2012 production models. Now, the law didn't even go into effect until 2014, so we were already 2 years behind. But it wasn't indexed, and so now here we are 10 years later dealing with record inflation, record interest rates, and we're still using a baseline of 2012 production costs. What we've seen over the last year, we've seen input costs skyrocket, in some cases over 100%, in some cases fertilizer, maybe even up to 300% increases in those costs. And so definitely that will be a first item up for bids is indexing the PLC. Now that'll be difficult because that's going to score, but I think it's necessary if we're going to keep our farmers competitive. And it's important that we maintain support for farmers because feeding and clothing our nation is a national security imperative.
Mr. Hodges, for 30 seconds.
Thank you. You know, we just need to ensure that we that our farmers have what they need to succeed. Again, you know, they're not your traditional earners like we are. You know, I receive a paycheck every 2 weeks, and they don't. So we have to ensure that they are safe. That we ensure that they have the tools they need
And we go back to the congressman for 30 seconds.
Some of the issues that farmers face are not in the purview of the Ag Committee and won't be part of the farm bill, but they need to be discussed. One of them is stepped up basis on the estate tax. We need to address that issue quickly. And the other issue is finding alternatives in the tax code to incentivize savings for self-funded disaster relief. I've got a bill to do this. It's called the FRAME Act, Farm Risk Abatement and Mitigation Election. I like acronyms, but the FRAME Act is a tax-deferred savings account that allows you to continue operation of your farm in a time of crisis in the event that you don't get disaster relief.
We will pause, gentlemen, for just a moment to allow me to remind the audience that the candidates can participate in a press conference directly following this debate. You at home may participate as well by watching, so scan the QR code on your screen. With your mobile device, you will see that QR code. We'll keep popping it up periodically through the balance of our exchange. Back to questions now. Ms. Munoz for Mr. Crawford.
And this is another viewer question coming from right here in Faulkner County. Will you support the proposed Right to Read Act, which supports funding to provide all public school students with access to a certified school librarian and a funded school library? Congressman Crawford, to you first.
Well, that sounds pretty good. I would have to say, probably without having read the legislation and not being familiar with it, honestly, I don't know the details of the legislation, but I certainly support the right to read and also support librarians. I think librarians are integral to our education, particularly in a K-12 scenario. So in general, I would say, yes, I would support the right to read, but I'd have to reserve the right to read the legislation before I can say definitively that I would support that legislation.
Mr. Hodges.
You know, reading is so fundamental. I have a 13-year-old, and I stay on him about, reading. And I buy him books. He has a large library. Books on, since I'm a banker, I have books on finance, have books on his culture, and things of that nature. And so, reading is fundamental. Again, I don't know much about the piece of legislation, but I would support anything that comes to ensuring that we put a book in kids' hands so that they can grow. Because once you get it in your head, no one can take that out. We're very active in my district in Blauville with the Dolly Parton Imaginary Reading Program, where every kid that's born receives a book, I think, for the first 5 years of their lives. We have stations set up throughout the city that you can go and get books out of to take home and read. So I'm extremely supportive of libraries. I'm extremely supportive of librarians. I'm extremely supportive of reading.
Mr. Crawford, for a half minute.
Yeah, I'll say it again. I think it's important that we learn to read. It improves our fluency and even in conversation. But our ability to read and our ability to write are critical tools for success in the workplace and in life.
Mr. Hodges.
I support literacy. I support reading. I support any efforts that will be made to ensure that, first of all, our libraries are safe and funded, and that we are putting books in our children's hands so they can grow.
Well, involving books and libraries and librarians and funding, the nation is seeing a wave of legislation involving reading and libraries on a cultural or social basis. In the largest city, gentlemen, in your congressional district, there is a movement underway to slash the library millage by half, and we're talking about the city of Jonesboro, of course. Mr. Hodges, I want your thoughts on that. Would you support that? What's going on?
Absolutely not. As a matter of fact, I received a call one day, and I got in my car and drove down to a meeting that they were having dealing with the library issue. It's been made political, and it shouldn't be, most definitely would not. I've always supported library funding, even when there was a threat to, they've cut it some, but there was a threat, they were trying to really reduce the funding for libraries, and I fought hard to ensure that we continue funding our library. So no, I would not support the effort in Craighead County and the things that they're doing to dismantle the libraries system they have there in that area. But and I've spoken and I've attended the meeting and addressed it and addressed my concerns as a lawmaker.
Congressman?
I think when you serve the public, whether that be as an appointed official or an elected official, in whatever capacity, I think you owe it to your constituency, the constituency that you serve, to be attuned to their needs and a reflection of the community. So we're not hearing both sides of this issue. What brought this issue to the fore was the fact that the library in Jonesboro was engaging in LGBTQ story hour for children, things of this nature, that is not an accurate reflection of the needs and desires of the community which it serves. And so the initiative to change that seems to have been met with resistance by the people at the library. And so while I don't like the idea of cutting funding to institutions that I think are important, I also don't like the idea of being indoctrinated by those institutions that are funded by taxpayer dollars. And so it's incumbent on this institution to make the appropriate changes, and we're not seeing that happen.
Mr. Hodges.
You know, there were people that had concerns about that issue, but you had those that didn't have a concern about that issue. So we have to ensure that we are speaking on behalf of all people, not just a certain section of folks that we represent. And it was political. We made it political, and we can't use our strong arms of politics and politicians to be bullies when it comes to issues like our libraries.
Back to the congressman.
Again, these public servants can and should be a reflection of the public that they serve. If the greater public has a problem with this, then it's incumbent on those individuals to listen to those folks and say, what can we do differently without discriminating, but at the same time, understanding the sensibilities and the sensitivities of the funding from which they derive their livelihoods.
Mr. Jared.
Congressman, Amendment 4 is on the ballot this election cycle. It would allow for the use of recreational marijuana. Do you support or oppose the amendment? And please give us some specific reasons why.
There are a couple of reasons, and maybe even more, why I don't support that amendment. I'll start with the liability issue for employers. When we now open up recreational use of marijuana, and you have a workforce that may avail themselves of that marijuana, you potentially set up a huge liability for the employer should an accident happen. We know that a lot of attorneys like to sue companies for scenarios like that. The other issue is finance. So right now it's a Schedule I drug at the federal level. If the state says we're not going to treat it that way and it's going to be a legitimate business, we're still putting our banks in a position to effectively be laundering money. So what we're seeing in places like Colorado where it is legal, you have those purveyors of marijuana that are sitting on stacks of cash. That presents a major crime problem and a major security problem. And look, our crime is bad enough in this country as it is.
We go to Mr. Hodges.
You know, I am a supporter of the amendment. You know, I am a banker, and those are some of the discussions we've had. We're going to have to look at ways to be able to bank those monies that are being made. The same with medical marijuana. You know, we have that issue. And I think that in the banking industry, those are things that we are definitely looking toward. But I am in support of the amendment for recreational marijuana.
Mr. Crawford?
Well, beyond just the liability issue to the employer, beyond the banking issue with regard to potential laundering under statute, there's also, I think, the social issues that we have to address. And there's people that will argue this point. I believe marijuana is a gateway drug. We have enough problems right now with fentanyl coming through our porous border because our president refuses to enforce our border and to maintain sovereignty on our border, that why would we want to exacerbate that problem with legalizing marijuana and then potentially opening up young people in particular to experimenting with other kinds of drugs?
Mr. Hodges, you have 30 seconds.
You know, he said he believes it's a gateway drug. We don't know if it's a gateway drug or not. So, you know, I'm just a firm believer that, you know, in the when it comes to the amendment, that we have so many young men that look like myself that have been incarcerated because of small amounts of marijuana being caught with or selling it. And so I think it's been an issue. So I support the
Christina Munoz.
So one of the biggest complaints I hear from Arkansans about politicians in Washington is that they participate in vote trading. I'll vote for your bill if you vote for mine. How will you ensure the people in your district that you will be voting what is best interest for them and not you? Mr. Hodges.
You know, me personally, it's about people, not politics. You know, I'm not going to D.C. to answer to Nancy Pelosi or anyone else. I'm going to D.C. to answer to the American people and the people of the 1st Congressional District. I've voted against and spoke against many of my colleagues' pieces of legislation that that I'm friends with from across the aisle. One particular story, I was sitting in the chamber, and I text one of my colleagues and said, I'm going to have to vote against your bill, and this is why. And he sent me a text back saying, well, I appreciate you letting me know, just as long as you're tactful and classy about it. And so, you know, it's not about appeasing your colleagues. It's not about appeasing your party. It's about the people at the end of the day. And so it's people over politics when it comes to me.
Congressman?
You know, I don't really experience that a lot. I've been focused on representing you, the folks of Arkansas's 1st Congressional District. That's my job. That's my priority. And so I think most people, if you don't support their bill and they come and ask you about it and you tell them, here's why I don't support it, they recognize that you've got a valid reason. And ultimately, on my voting card, it says the 1st District of Arkansas. It doesn't say Wisconsin or Illinois or California. My responsibility is to represent the 1st District of Arkansas, and I think most people respect that. In fact, I've had some pretty heated conversations because I wouldn't go along with certain things like budgets. Because of the things that we talked about earlier about the fundamental problem we have with spending taxpayer money. And so I've kind of earned the reputation of being my own man, if you will, and advocating for the 1st District of Arkansas. And I don't trade votes, and I really don't know anybody who does.
Mr. Hodges, you have another 30 seconds.
You know, my opponent says he's voted for the 1st District, but going through my list of legislation, looks like most of everything that has been voted on has been a no that would help the 1st Congressional District, like infrastructure, you know, like the CHIPS Act, which, you know, people have waited years to get automobiles because we couldn't get the chips that were needed to go in these automobiles or in appliances and things like that. We have poor roads and bridges in the 1st Congressional District. So,
Mr. Crawford, you have another 30 seconds, sir.
Yeah, I think we get a little bit confused about what a good bill is and what a bad bill is. The IIJA, the Infrastructure Investment and Jobs Act, was a terrible bill, as I mentioned before. All it will do is accelerate inflation and drive interest rates up higher. It wasn't a good bill for Arkansas. It wasn't a good bill for the 1st District. That's why I voted against it. In fact, I didn't even get an opportunity to weigh in on that bill. So talk about vote trading. I wouldn't even have the opportunity to trade votes because they didn't give Republicans the opportunity to engage in that so-called bipartisan bill.
Gentlemen, thank you. I would like to go back, Mr. Crawford, and to both of you, again, to the library issue in Jonesboro. Congressman, you seem to be suggesting that library materials and offerings should be subject to review, but popular opinion. Is that correct?
Well, what I'm saying is popular opinion drives an awful lot. I mean, the reality is if you have an individual who likes pornography, should we put pornography in the library? Well, my opponent says yes, because we need to serve everybody. So let's put pornography in the library. No, I think we certainly do draw lines. I don't think it's appropriate to indoctrinate or sexualize children. So I think anybody would agree with that. So however you go about indoctrinating or sexualizing children, I would think that was wrong, and I think most people would agree with that. And if that's the case here, why would you not try to reflect the wishes of the people that you purport to serve? I think that's the heart of this issue, and that's not what's being talked about. And so I think it's important that the folks at the library reflect on what their mission is to serve the broader community. And yeah, there may be some individuals who would like to see that. Maybe you could be a little more discreet in the way you present it. Maybe you could have a section that is dedicated over here that has a disclaimer that when you come into this section of the library, you may be exposed to things that might be offensive. But they didn't even make that effort.
Mr. Hodges, you have 1 minute.
You know, to say porn is kind of stretching a little bit far. You know, I have a 13-year-old son, and he and I take him to the library. You know, he has a decision to make, and I as a parent have a decision to make. I'm not going to take him to an area that I know that is inappropriate for my child because I'm the adult. And so, you know, we serve people. We serve all people. That's capital A-L-L, all people. And for us to categorize, to section people off into categories and to say this person's right and this person's wrong is not the way we should operate. And I think that's the way of thinking. When you have a group of people with their narrow-minded views to come against the libraries because they feel a certain way, and that's just not how we should operate.
Congressman?
So we have a parental advisory for lyrics and content on music. We have parental advisories on movies. We have rating scales and so on. But what I'm hearing is that's not appropriate to do at the library if we have material that could be offensive. You know what? It seems like the left is offended by everything, and yet they don't want to entertain the notion that some people might find that material offensive, and therefore maybe we should warn folks, because you know the left likes trigger warnings. Why don't we warn folks that there might be some material in here that some might find offensive?
And Mr. Hodges, you have 30 seconds.
Parental, as I said, I'm a parent. I take my son to the library, so I oversee what he can and cannot do. As far as the left, we want to throw this blame game, and we want to be divisive on issues, but it's a people issue. It's an all people issue at the end of the day. I want to do what's best for everyone across the board, not just a section of folks.
Gentlemen, wish we could continue with the questions, but the time has arrived for closing statements, and again, as determined by the toss of a coin. Mr. Hodges, you're first, sir. You have one minute.
Look, I'm Arkansas State Representative Monte Hodges, a little boy from the Delta, born and raised in Mississippi County, single mother. She raised four babies. Saw her get up early in the morning, go to work, and she raised us to work hard. She drug the church every Sunday to love God, to love family, and to love community. I've served my district. They sent me back to Little Rock 5 times to be their voice. And I asked them to send me to D.C. to be a voice for all people. I've proven it in Eastern Arkansas, what can happen when you put the work in. I want to take that Mississippi County miracle that I've seen in my district throughout the entire first district, so they can have all the opportunities. We in the Delta want all the opportunities. We want all the amenities and all the things that any other community has. We want good roads and bridges, good infrastructure, good rural broadband. We want affordable health care. We want our teachers to make a livable wage. So I'm Monte Hodges. Elect me for Congress for the 1st Congressional District. Thank you.
Mr. Hodges, thank you. Mr. Crawford, you have 1 minute.
Thank you, sir. I'm going to talk straight to the folks here at 1st Congressional District. We are living in difficult times, and you know it. You're living those times as well. Our nation's facing challenges at home and abroad, skyrocketing interest rates, rampant inflation. We have an overbearing, rising, belligerent China that's fueling our fentanyl crisis, coming across our border unchecked, Ukraine at war with Russia. President Biden, when he got elected, promised to be a unifier. Instead, he's been a divider, and he's driven our economy to the brink of collapse. And all along, Speaker Nancy Pelosi has been his willing accomplice. We need to reverse course before it's too late. We can't trust Speaker Pelosi to lead any longer. I'm your Congressman, Rick Crawford. It's been my privilege to serve you for the last several years. I'm asking for your vote on November 8th, and together, we can help reverse course and save this nation.
Once again, gentlemen, we thank you for your time.